everyone, welcome back to our channel Chemi Friends. So today we'll be solving GATE 2017 paper. I have not included mathematics section and general aptitude. So without wasting any time, let's get into the video.
So this question is the application of theorem of corresponding states, which states that all the fluids, when we compare at the same reduced temperature and reduced pressure, will have the same compressibility factor and they will deviate from the ideality. So let's see what we get as reduced temperature and reduced pressure. So reduced temperature is P by PC. PC is the critical pressure. And reduced temperature is T by TC, which is critical temperature. So we have the values for M and for N. So for gas M, the temperature was 300 and critical temperature is 150. So put in this part and we'll get reduced temperature as 2. Similarly, for the reduced pressure, we have 25 bar and 75 bar. So P by PC we will do and we'll get 1/3. Similarly, for gas N, we have the values. Let's substitute that and we'll get TR, or reduced temperature, as 2 and reduced pressure as 1/3. So we have the same reduced temperature and reduced pressure. Therefore, the compressibility factors will also be the same, which is Zm is equals to Zn. Option C is correct. So this question is a very simple one. If you remember that flow rate, volumetric flow rate, is directly proportional to the pressure drop in venturimeter, then you can easily solve this question. So they have given the Q2 by Q1 value, which is 2. And we know that volumetric flow rate is directly proportional to pressure drop. So Q2 by Q1 is equals to square root of pressure drops. So yeah, just substitute the values and basic mathematics, you will get the answer as 4. So option B is correct. In this question, we have to tell the correct sequence of equipment for size reduction of solids. So the correct sequence will be jaw crusher, hammer mill and fluid energy mill, because the jaw crusher will produce particles which are bigger than hammer mill and fluid energy mill. So the finest particles will be produced in fluid energy mill. Moving on to the next question. Oh, this looks quite complicated, but it's not. So it's a simple problem. It says a gas bubble whose density and diameter is given is rising vertically through water. So the force balance they have given, okay, this is the force balance, and V is the velocity of the bubble at any time. We have to assume that volume of the rising bubble is not changing, and we have to calculate the terminal rising velocity of the bubble, which is this velocity. So at terminal velocity, we know that acceleration is zero because the net force on the object is zero. So acceleration means dv by dt will become zero. Okay, now you can take this part to this side and solve. So coming back to this part, we can isolate this velocity and take all the components to this side, and whatever is being cancelled, we can cancel them. And the other things, which is g, acceleration due to gravity, we have the value. For the diameter, we have the value. Viscosity also, we have the value. And from density, and for density of the gas, that also we have. So we can easily calculate the velocity of the bubble, which is 5.43 into 10 to the power minus 3 meter per second. But we need to give the value in centimeters per second and up to 2 decimal places. So the answer is 0.54 centimeters per second. Okay, they have given one dimensional unsteady state heat conduction equation, which is this. And they are asking the value of n. So if you remember the unsteady state heat conduction equation in cylindrical coordinate system, so it is given by this, and they have already said that it is 1D, so we can cancel out these two terms. Okay, so we are left with this one and this, which is quite similar to the to what they have given us. So we can see that the value of n is nothing but 1. So the correct option is B. Moving on to the next question. So this one is also very easy. They have given that in a heat exchanger, inner dia and outer dia is 25 and 30 mm. They have given the overall heat transfer coefficient based on inner area. So we have to find out the overall heat transfer coefficient based on the outer area. So for that, we have this simple equation which we can use it. So U naught is overall heat transfer coefficient based on outer area. T naught is the diameter of outer area, and Ui overall heat transfer coefficient of inner area. Di is the inner diameter. So we know outer dia, inner heat transfer coefficient and inner dia. So all we need to do is just substitute these values and we will get outer heat transfer coefficient as 300 watt per meter square degree Celsius. Let's see what the next question is. So which of the following conditions are valid at plate point? So first of all, I would like to tell you that plate point is that particular point where the extract phase and raffinate phase intersect. So when they intersect, there is no separation possible. At this point, they become coincident and no separation is possible. So let us see what the options are. Density difference between extract and raffinate phases is zero. Interfacial tension becomes zero and composition difference becomes zero. So for the plate point, all the three points are valid. So the correct option is D. Moving on to the next question. So we have to find out the Murphy efficiency based on vapor phase. So let us consider that a tray N is this. So the composition of vapor which will be leaving the tray will be represented by YN, and which is entering the tray will be represented by YN plus 1. So it is better if you remember this Murphy efficiency formula, which is this, and this YN star is equilibrium composition. We have all these values. See, the composition of vapor entering a tray in distillation column is 0.47, which is YN plus 1, and composition which is leaving the tray is 0.53, which is YN, and equilibrium composition is 0.52, which is YN star. So all we need to do is just substitute these values and get the answer. We got it as 1.2, but we have to give it in the percentage, so 120% is the correct answer. Moving on to the next question. So this is a mass transfer problem. They have given that consider steady state mass transfer of solute A from gas phase to liquid phase, and they have given us the bulk and interface mole fractions. Also, this ratio is very close to zero. So we need to tell the mass transfer resistance is negligible in which phase, gas phase or in liquid phase or in both the phases. If you remember that we can write mass transfer coefficients like this for interface and the bulk phase. And if you see that this ratio, if you take this here and this ratio is quite similar to what they have given us. So this is zero, very close to zero. So we are left with Ky by Kx approximately equal to zero. So this means that this Kx, which is mass transfer coefficient in liquid phase, is much greater than Ky. That is why it is almost equal to zero. This means that 1 over Kx is very less than 1 over ky. So the correct option is B. Moving on to the next question, we have to tell which amongst the following reactor configurations gives the total volume of the reactors. The feed is pure A and 90% conversion is desired. So 90% conversion somewhere will be here, and the reaction scheme is also given, which is A goes to P. The reaction rate is represented by minus RA and conversion as XA. Okay, so we can assume that the first reaction which is occurring in the reactor is 50%, which is here. And let us see the reactor configurations one by one. So the first is CSTR followed by PFR. We know that area under the curve gives the total volume of the reactor. So for CSTR, the area under the curve is a rectangle. So this is the area under the curve for CSTR. For PFR, the area under the curve will be this one. So this is the first option. Now let us look at the second option. For that, we can make a graph. Okay, this is somewhere 50%, this is 90%, and two CSTR in series. That means one rectangle under the curve will be this one, and the second rectangle under the curve will be this. And you can clearly see in both the schemes that CSTR followed by PFR gives the lowest total volume of the reactors. So option A is less than B. Now we will see PFR followed by CSTR. Now let us compare C with A, because A was the lowest in A and B. So the PFR followed by CSTR. So the PFR area under the curve will be this. For CSTR, area under the curve will be this rectangle. And again, we can see that A, option A, is less than option C. Now comparing D with A. So the option D is a single PFR. So a single PFR will be this. Area under the curve will be this. This whole thing. So even this, we can clearly see that the volume of the reactor is more than option A. So the total lowest volume of the reactor will be given by CSTR followed by PFR, which is the correct answer. It's a very simple problem. All you need to tell is expression for Thiele modulus. And if you remember, the correct option is B, where R is the length of the pellet, TE is the effective diffusivity, and K1 is the rate constant. So Thiele modulus is represented as R square root of K1 by DE. Moving on to the next question. So they have asked us which statement is always true in case of solid catalyzed gas phase reversible reaction. So the correct option here will be C, solid catalyst never affects equilibrium conversion. In question number 20th, we have to match group 1 with group 2. So basically, this is like which instruments are used to measure temperature, liquid level, vacuum, and concentration. So the correct option is C, because temperature can be measured by thermistor, liquid level can be measured by capacitance probe, Vacuum can be measured by McLeod gauge, and concentration can be measured by chromatograph. So according to this, the correct option is C. Moving on to the next question. An LVDT, which is linear variable differential transformer, is a transducer used for converting. So a transducer is used for converting displacement into voltage, and hence the correct option is A. Coming to the question number 22, they have given us the cost of new pump, which is 24,000 rupees. Also, they have told us that the useful life is 10 years. The salvage value is 4,000 rupees, and we have to assume straight line depreciation. For straight line depreciation, there are certain formulas, and we have to tell the book value at the end of the fourth year. So for straight line depreciation, VS, which is salvage value, is equals to V minus A into D. So D is the depreciation. We have to find out the depreciation first. So after finding out the depreciation, we can find out the book value at the end of the fourth year. We have the value V, which is 24,000 rupees, that is cost of new pump. Salvage value we know, which is 4,000 rupees, and A is basically useful life. So useful life is 10 years. From here, we can find out that depreciation is 2,000 rupees per year. So the book value at the end of the fourth year will be V, which is for 24,000 rupees. Fourth year, that's it, as in A is 4 in this case, and D is depreciation. So the value at the end of the fourth year is rupees 16,000 rupees. In this question, we have to tell DCDA process is used for the manufacturing of what chemical. So it is used in the manufacturing of sulfuric acid. Moving on to the next question, we have to match the polymerization processes with the polymers. So free radical polymerization is used for the manufacturing of PVC, which is polyvinyl chloride. Zeigler-Nata polymerization is used for the manufacturing of polypropylene. And the last, condensation polymerization is used for nylon 66. So the correct option will be B. Next question. The purpose of methanation reaction used in ammonia plants is to. So the main purpose of doing methanation is to remove carbon monoxide, as it is a catalyst poison. It will hamper the process. The next question is initial value problem. They have given us dx by dt is equals to sin t, and the value of x at t is equals to 0 is also 0. So we have to find out the value of x at t is equals to pi by 3. This is a simple problem. Just integrate it, take dt to other side and integrate. So on integrating, we will get this. Now we have to find out this constant. For finding out this constant, there is this one condition which they have given. So we'll use this condition here. Put the value of t as 0, and x is also 0 because it was already given. So the c will be 1. Now we can find out the value of x at t is equals to pi by 3. So cos minus cos pi by 3 is minus 1 by 2. The value of c we know, it is plus 1. So the value of x is 0.5. Moving on to the next question, the Laplace transform of a function is given. So we have to find out the initial and final values. So all we need to do here is use initial value theorem and final value theorem. According to initial value theorem, limit t tends to 0, f of t is equals to limit s tends to infinity s f of s. So we know what is f of s. Just substitute the value of f of s, which is s plus 1 over s, s plus 2. So these two will get cancelled. And simple mathematics, take s common and then substitute the limit. So you will get answer as 1, which is initial value. Moving on to the next part of this question, which is final value. So this is the final value theorem. Substitute the value of f of s and cancel these s and then put the limit. So the limit is 0. When you substitute 0 in place of s, we will get 1 by 2 as answer. So the correct option is B. Next question. So it's a simple mass balance problem over a crystallizer. Okay, they have given us the feed temperature. Salt concentration in the feed is 48%. The salt crystallizes as pentahydrate and the crystal and mother liquor leave the crystallizer. And the solubility is also given. So we have to find out the feed flow rate required for the production of 100 kgs per second of the hydrated salt. So this is a crystallizer. There's this feed. So at the end you will get some crystals and you will get one mother liquor. Okay, so feed is equals to crystal plus liquid, basic overall mass balance. C, we know that it is 100 kgs per second. Okay, the solubility of the salt is 0.2. And the composition of crystal we can find out as they have given us the molecular weight of the salt. We have found out the value of composition of crystals. Now a simple solute balance we have to do. We have all the values, which is XF. We have the value of XC, composition of salt in the crystals and composition of salt in the liquid. Just substitute all this and we will simply solve equation 1 and 2. And when we solve equation 1 and 2, you will get the feed value as 200 kgs per second. So this question is about energy balance. They have told that reaction A to B is carried out in a reactor at steady state. And 1 mole per second of pure A enters the reactor. So the outlet stream leaves the reactor at 325 degrees Celsius. The heat input, which is Q, is 17 kilowatts, and the heat of the reaction, which is delta H, is 30 kilojoules per mole. The specific heats are 0.1 and 0.15. We have to find out the molar flow rate of B, which is leaving the reactor. The basic energy balance equation will be FA naught CPA, the difference between the temperature, plus the heat of the reaction, plus feed rate of B multiplied by specific heat of B multiplied by the temperature difference, plus whatever the heat input is. So I have separated these terms and named it as delta H1, delta H2 and delta H3. So that it becomes easy just for the calculation purpose. So we have all these values, and on substituting the values, we will get the first term as minus 40. So I have written it here. Delta H2, which is heat of the reaction multiplied by molar flow rate of A, which is 30. I have written it here. Now the B, which we have to find out this value FB, molar flow rate of B, which is leaving the reactor. So after substituting these two terms, we got 45 F of B, and minus 17 was the heat input. So we can easily find out the value of molar flow rate of B, which is 0.60 moles per second. We have to find out the change in molar Gibbs free energy of a liquid, and they have given us the molar volume, change in the molar volume, which is this, and the isothermal compressibility is also given. The pressure of a liquid is increased isothermally. Isothermally means dT is zero. So using a fundamental equation of for Gibbs free energy, so this term will get zero because it is isothermal. So we are left with this. Okay. Now here isothermal compressibility, which is represented by beta, minus 1 over V del V by del P at constant temperature is 10 to the power minus 9 Pascal inverse. This is given. If you compare this and this, can you put VdP as del V by minus beta, minus del V by beta? We can equate these two equations, correct? So this will become this. We can substitute the values of delta V, which is given 50.45 into 10 to the power minus 6 and 48 into 10 to the power minus 6. Okay, after substituting all this, we will get delta G, which is the change in molar Gibbs free energy, as 2450 joules per mole. Question 33. So here we have to find out the mole percentage of solute in liquid phase. Let's read the question. A gas is in equilibrium with solvent at 10 bar. The mole fraction of the gas phase of solvent in gas phase is given. Fugacity coefficient and Henry's law constant is also given, assuming that it obeys Henry's law. So from Henry's law, we know that this is the valid relation. We have the Henry's constant. We have the value of fugacity coefficient, composition in the gas phase also we have, pressure also we have. So after substituting all the values, we will get mole percentage of solute as 0.91. In this question, the vapor pressure of pure substance at temperature T is 30 bar. So it's given saturated pressure is 30 bar. The actual and ideal gas values of G by RT is also given, which is 7 and 7.7. So the difference between actual and ideal gas values of G by RT is nothing but excess Gibbs free energy, which is GE by RT. So from here, GE by RT is minus 0.7. Also, we know that fugacity coefficient, which is ln of Fi, is equals to GE by RT. We can find out the value of phi I, and we know that F is equals to phi I times P sat, which is the saturated pressure. So if we have this value, P saturated is already 30 bar, we know that we can easily calculate F, which is the fugacity at of saturated liquid. So for that, we will substitute the value of GE by RT, which is minus 0.7, and calculate phi I. Once we have phi I, so it is easy to calculate the fugacity, which is phi I into P saturated. And the correct answer is 14.89 bar. They have said you have to round it to one decimal place, so you can write it as 14.9 bar. Moving on to the next question, we have to find out the shear stress at the pipe wall. So the shear stress at the pipe wall can be given by this formula. So it is delta P by L to tau by R, where tau is the shear stress. We know the value of delta P, which is given as 500 pascals. Length also we know, which is 10 meters. Radius we know, it is 1.25 into 10 to the power minus 2 meters. And just substitute and you can find out the value of shear stress, which is tau, and it is 0.3125 pascals. They have said that you have to round it to two decimal places, so it can be 0.31. So this question is related to Moody charts. I hope you remember them. I have just made a small representation of it. As you observe that As the Reynolds number increases, the F value, which is the fanning friction factor value, that also increases. So according to that theory, if we go, you just have to observe these four sets. In set one, you can observe that as the Reynolds number increases, this is decreasing. So this is obviously not an option. Set four, similarly, this is also not valid. Similarly, set two, here it is increasing, but at some point it started decreasing. So again, but this set three, we can observe that it is constantly increasing as the Reynolds number increases. So this is the correct option. Moving on to the next question. A propeller whose diameter is given rotates at n is equals to 1 revolutions per second. They have given that the propeller tip velocity is pi nb and the lab scale model is 1/100th of the size of actual propeller. So we have to find out the rotation speed of the lab scale model. That Froude number is v square by rg. So v, they have given it is pi nd, r is d by 2 obviously, and g is acceleration due to gravity. So if we see this, we will get the final result as n square d by g, where n is the revolutions per second. So if when we have to find out the lab scale and scale up thing, we'll just see the parameters. So they have given that lab scale is 1/100th of the size of the actual propeller. So the lab scale dia will be 15/100 because the actual model is 15 meters in dia. And the number of revolutions of actual model is 1. And here for the lab scale, we have to find out. So when you substitute all this, so the number of revolutions per second will be 10. Next question. We have to find out the mass mean dia, which is very easy. You just have to apply this formula, which is the product of diameter and mass fraction, and you have to sum over it. So the final answer is 13 mm. In this question, we have to find out the black body radiation intensity emitted by a black body over all wavelengths. So basically, it's a simple direct formula question. If you remember it, you will be able to do it. So the correct option here is C. Let us move to the next question. A fluid flows over a horizontal heated plate maintained at temperature TW. The temperature profile is given, where Y is the vertical distance from the plate, and delta T is the thickness of the thermal boundary layer, and K is the thermal conductivity of the fluid. We have to find out the local heat transfer coefficient. So, as we can predict from the question that both conduction and convection is taking place. So, the governing equation is this, where this represents convection and this represents conduction. So, we'll just modify this equation a bit, where we'll take the difference between the temperature to the another side, and the local heat transfer coefficient will be equal to minus K, difference between the temperature multiplied by the temperature gradient. So this can be found out by the temperature profile. This one you can differentiate T with respect to Y. So we'll differentiate on differentiating, we got this equation, and we have to find out the value at Y is equals to 0. So we'll put that, and the value at Y is equals to 0 is this. Now put this here, and the local heat transfer coefficient will be minus K TW minus T infinity multiplied by the value of dt by dy at y is equals to 0. This and this will get cancelled, and we are left with 3k by 2 delta t. Moving on to the next question. In nucleate boiling, the pressure inside a bubble is higher than the pressure of the surrounding liquid. Assuming that both liquid and vapor are saturated, the temperature of the liquid will always be, since this is a case of nucleate boiling, so nucleate boiling occurs when the temperature of vapor is greater than the temperature of liquid. So here the correct statement is, the temperature of liquid should be lower than the temperature of vapor. Moving on, the vapor phase composition and relative volatilities are given. We have to find out the mole fraction of N propane in liquid phase. Okay, they have given us the mole fraction of methane, ethane and propane in vapor phase. We have to find out the mole fraction of N propane in liquid phase. So we know that relative volatility and mole fractions are related by this formula. So it's very easy. First of all, find out the mole fraction of methane in liquid phase. The relative volatility of methane we know, and mole fraction in vapor phase we know for methane. We can easily get the value of mole fraction in liquid phase. Similarly for ethane, and we know that the sum of the mole fraction should be 1. Since we have the mole fraction of methane, mole fraction of ethane, we can easily find out the mole fraction of propane. Next question. They have given us the correlation for Sherwood number, and we have to find out the correct expression for Chilton-Colburn factor. Okay, so we know that Chilton-Colburn factor is given by this expression. All you need to do is just substitute the Sherwood number expression here and just a little bit of mathematics. That's it. And you'll get the Chilton-Colburn factor as this. This and this will get cancelled and you are left with this one. Let us see this question. So the liquid phase second order reaction is carried out in an isothermal CSTR at steady state. The reaction is given. Okay, the reactor volume is also given. Inlet concentration, which is CA0, is given. And volumetric flow rate is given. You have to find out the fractional conversion. So we know that tau is equals to V by V naught, where V is the volume of the reactor and V naught is the volumetric flow rate, which is equals to Ca naught minus C upon minus of Ra, which is the rate of the reaction and which it was given 0.005 Ca square. All you need to do is just substitute the values. Ca can be written as Ca naught 1 minus XA. Okay, so this we will put in place of CA here also, and we'll be left and we will get this equation. So CA naught and CA naught will get cancelled. We know the value of CA naught, which is, I think it was 1000. Yeah, so the value of CA0 is 1000 and XA upon 1 minus XA square will be 20. We'll take all this here and solve for XA. And on solving, we'll get XA as 0.8. In question 58, they have given us the transfer function of the system. And we have to tell for a unit step increase in the input, the fractional overshoot will be. So we know that the fractional overshoot is given by this formula, and this can be compared with the general equation, which is 1 over tau s whole square plus 2 zeta tau s plus 1. So from here, tau square will be 4 because we are comparing both the equations. So tau will be 2. And for 2 zeta tau, will be equal to 1.2. Again, on comparison, so we know the value of tau, which is 2. So the zeta value will be 0.3. All you need to do now is just substitute the value of zeta in this equation and you will get the fractional overshoot value, which is 0.3725. And they have told us to round it to two decimal places, so it will be 0.37. Let us have a look at the next question. A bond has a maturity value of 20,000 rupees at the end of 4 years. The interest is compounded at 5% per year. And we have to tell the initial investment to be made. Okay, so we all know that S is equals to P 1 plus interest to the power N. So here we know the value of S, which is the maturity value. We know the value of interest rate and we know the value of N, which is the number of years. So we can find out the value of P, and after substituting all the given values, we get the value of P as 16,454 rupees. So the total cost function is given and there are two variables X and Y. We have to find out the optimal value of the total cost and it should be rounded up to one decimal place. So whenever we have to find any optimal value, it's better to differentiate our cost function with respect to the variables. So we'll partially differentiate our cost function with respect to X and we will again differentiate our cost function with respect to variable Y. Let's look at the solution. This is a cost function. We'll differentiate it and equate it to zero to find out the optimal values. So when we differentiate our cost function with respect to X, we will get this, and when we differentiate it with respect to Y, we will get this. Now we have two equations and two variables. We can solve them, and on solving, we can put the values of X and Y in our first equation. Or if you don't want to put the values of X and Y, you can put the value of X because you have already found out the value of Y in terms of X. So you can substitute Y with 2X in this equation and you can solve this equation with the help of X only. And the final answer which we will get is 91.53. So it has to be rounded up to one decimal place. So it can be 91.5. So in the last question, we have to match the equipment with the processes. So the fluidized bed is in the process of catalytic cracking. Multi-stage adiabatic reactor with interstage cooling is used in SO2 oxidation, sulfur dioxide oxidation. Diaphragm cell is used in sodium hydroxide manufacture and Ford Rainier machine is used in paper making. The correct option is A.
I hope this video is useful to you guys. So don't forget to like, share and subscribe. Also, please follow our Instagram page. The link is in the description box below.